graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents William W. Johnstone's Smoke Jensen, the Mountain Man, 48, Texas Kill of the Mountain Man, by William W. Johnstone and J.A. Johnstone. Narrated by Mort, Shelby, and performed by a full cast. Outside of the small house in Laramie County, Wyoming, Emma was hanging up her wash when she saw a rider approaching. At first, she felt a sense of joy, thinking perhaps her husband was returning from his trip. But as that rider got closer, her joy turned to dread.
My husband isn't here.
That's good, because I didn't come to see him. I came to see you.
What do you want, Marvin?
You know what I want, Emma. I want you. I always wanted you. Come with me now. We can start a new life somewhere else, just you and me.
No, Marvin. I made my choice a long time ago.
How can I convince you that you made the wrong choice?
You can't convince me because I didn't make the wrong choice.
All right, then. At least invite me up for a cup of coffee. I come a long way today and you owe me that much.
What do you mean, I owe you? Why would I owe you anything?
Let's just say it's for the memory of the way it once was between us.
There was never anything between us, Marvin. Except perhaps in your own imagination.
Then at least let me leave with some dignity. A shared cup of coffee, perhaps? What would that hurt?
All right. One cup of coffee. Then I want you to please leave. I need to finish hanging out my laundry. Come on.
Marvin followed Emma into the house, and as soon as the door was closed behind him, he grabbed her, then turned her around. As she fought with him, he forced a kiss on her.
You want me. You know you do.
Emma broke free and slapped Marvin.
No, no, go away. Leave me alone.
Marvin smiled at her, but the malevolent smile was without warmth.
All right, bitch. Like you said, you made your choice.
He pulled out his pistol and brought it down on her head. The world went black around Emma, and she fell forever. As she regained consciousness, the first thing she was aware of was the floor beneath her prone body. Her eyes opened, and Emma saw Marvin standing above her. He was buttoning his jeans as he looked down at her naked and bruised body.
If I can't have you, he can't either.
Marvin pulled his pistol and shot her in the stomach.
Goodbye, Emma.
Three months later, Smoke Jensen was in Longmont's saloon, sitting at Lewis Longmont's special table with the proprietor himself.
What are you doing in town at this time of day, Smoke? Is there not enough to keep you busy out at Sugarloaf?
We're gathering some horses to take down to Texas, but Pearlie and Cal seem to have things well in hand.
Smoke looked over at a table of card players.
Who's your new girl?
What are you talking about? I don't have a new girl.
That one.
Smoke pointed to an attractive young red-haired woman who was setting drinks before the four card players. Though what she was wearing was as provocative as what was being worn by any of the other bar girls, even Smoke could tell that her dress was more expensively made. Smoke recognized only two of the players.
Oh, she isn't working for me. She came in with a man in the suit.
That card player wore a black suit with a red vest over a white collared shirt with a black string tie. His dark hair was perfectly coiffured, and his mustache, which didn't extend beyond each end of his lips, was well trimmed.
But you have changed the subject. What brought you to town in the middle of the day?
Sally has some things to do, so I volunteered to come with her to help out.
Yes, one can easily see that you're being a big help.
I am being a big help. Sally said I would be most helpful just by staying out of her way. Anyway, I had to take care of something down at Earl's.
What did you need done at the blacksmith shop?
Nothing major. Some angle irons for bracing some new shelves in my machine shop.
When they looked toward the source of the scream, they saw that someone had grabbed the red-haired woman who'd been the subject of Smoke's earlier observation. The woman's assailant had his arm around her neck. He was holding his pistol to her head, but his attention at this moment was fixed on the well-dressed man who sat at the card table.
You've been cheating, mister. You've been cheating from the moment I sat down here, and this woman's been helping you.
What are you talking about? I haven't done anything.
Don't give me none of that, lady. Do you think I don't know how you've been sneaking around behind all of us, giving him signals and such on what cards we is holding? Now, all of you, get up and leave the money on the table. We've been cheated out of a lot of money, and I plan to get back my share of what he stole.
Smoke stood up and started walking toward the table while aiming his pistol at the man who was holding the woman hostage. Because everyone's attention was on the scene playing out before him, neither they nor the man with the gun saw Smoke until he was within 10 feet of the table. When the man did see Smoke, he jerked around, still holding his gun to the woman's head.
Stop right there, mister. What is it you think you're about to do?
I'm not real sure, but it could be that I'm about to kill you.
Are you blind? Don't you see that I have a gun pointed towards this woman's head?
Now that you mention it, I have noticed that. By the way, you might also have noticed that my gun is pointed at you.
Well, drop it now, or I'll kill the girl.
All right. Go ahead.
What? Look, you don't understand. If you don't drop the gun now, I'm gonna kill her.
Yeah, you said that already. The truth is, mister, you're in a bit of a fix here, aren't you? If you move that gun towards me, I'll kill you. If you shoot the woman, I'll kill you. So if you're going to shoot her, go ahead and do it. If you don't drop it, I may just go ahead and shoot her myself so we can get this over with.
I don't believe you.
Why not? I don't know her, so she doesn't mean anything to me.
The man who was holding the woman looked at Smoke and saw the black hole of the end of the pistol pointed straight at him. His eyes grew wide in fear, and small beads of perspiration popped out on his forehead and his upper lip.
I'll give you to the count of three to make up your mind. One.
You're crazy.
Two.
No, no!
The man dropped his gun and took his arm away from the woman's neck. Quickly, the woman darted away from her would-be assailant to join the suited man at the table.
Thank you, mister. You saved my life.
Yeah, well, this would have never come up if you hadn't been helping your man cheat.
What? I never...
Smoke looked to the card player who worked at the stable.
Ivan, are you a winner or loser?
Are you kidding? I'm down 14 bucks. Dobbins is losing too.
Ivan nodded to the cowhand across the table from him.
Dobbins, how much money are you down?
Oh, I'm down $22. It's damn foolish of me to lose that much money. That's a month's pay for me.
Smoke eyed the would-be gunman.
What is your name, mister? And how much have you lost?
My name's Crabtree. Buster Crabtree. And I've lost $28, all to him.
Crabtree pointed directly across the table.
And who would you be, mister?
My name is Clemens. Roy J. Clemens.
Judging from your accent, I'd say you're a little out of your territory, aren't you? What are you doing in a place like Big Rock?
Sue and I arrived by train this morning. We're on the way to San Francisco, where I've taken employment at the Blue Chip Club. I'm sure that someone like you has never been to San Francisco, so no doubt you've never heard of the club.
The Blue Chip Club is a gambling establishment on Lombard Street.
You know the place?
Yeah. I also know that it has a reputation for hiring gamblers who can assure that the house wins by manipulating the cards.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Mr. Clemens, there's no doubt in my mind but that you are cheating these three men, and I'm quite sure your woman was involved in it in some way. I don't approve of what Mr. Crabtree did, but I can understand what drove him to do it. So here's what you're going to do. You are going to return the $28 to Mr. Crabtree, the $22 to Mr. Dobbins, and the $14 to Ivan. Then each of you men are going to take out whatever money you have put into the pot for this hand. Gentlemen, this game is over.
Now just why the hell should I do such a thing?
Because I'm holding a gun and you aren't. And I could kill you long before you can get that holdout gun you're keeping just under the bright red vest.
Clemens began counting out the money to return it to the other three players.
And here I thought you were my hero for saving me. Why, you are nothing but a thief with a gun.
Yes, ma'am. Well, some folks steal with a gun, and some folks steal by using a good-looking woman to signal what the other card players are holding. Mr. Crabtree, we aren't going to have any more trouble with you, are we?
No, sir. I'm satisfied that all's well, and I apologize for making such a damn fool of myself. I also thank you for being the only one of the two of us to show any sense this morning.
Lewis came over to stand by Smoke.
Mr. Clemens, I believe you said that you arrived on the morning train.
I did.
Then it is my suggestion that you return to the depot and await the earliest train that can take you out of town.
You've got no right to order me to stay in the depot.
Yes, that's true. I can only offer that as a suggestion. However, as the owner of this saloon, I can and I am telling you to leave my establishment now and never come in here again.
Yes, well, you certainly don't have to tell me that. I've no intention of remaining in an establishment, the owner of which would countenance robbery at gunpoint. Nor do I intend to stay in this town any longer than the very next train. Come, Sue, let's get out of this place.
Smoke and Lewis returned to their seats.
So, when are you going to Texas?
Just as soon as we get the horses gathered and broken that we'll be taking to Big Ben Conyers at the Live Oak Ranch near Fort Worth.
Why do they call him Big Ben?
Well, he's 6'7" tall, and he weighs nearly 300 pounds.
That is a big man.
He's also a pretty big man in Tarrant County, and I'm not just talking about his size.
Sally Jensen had returned to the Sugarloaf Ranch before Smoke. Now, she stood on the wide porch of the house, watching a plume of dust in the long, dedicated road that approached the ranch. She smiled. The rider passed under an entry that had the name of the ranch fashioned from wrought iron letters in the arch above. Smoke galloped into the compound before pulling the horse to a stop and leaping down from the saddle. Sally stepped out to the railing to look down at her husband.
Well, it does my heart good to know that you still think of me as someone you would gallop home to.
Sally, my love, I would soak my trousers in kerosene and ride through a forest fire to get home to you.
What? And expose Seven to such danger?
If I asked it of Seven, he would do it without hesitation. He's the greatest horse in the world.
Smoke, you have said that about every other horse you have ever owned, and you have named every one of them Seven.
That's true. How are things going here?
Oh, here comes Pearly. You can ask him yourself.
Is Earl going to be able to get them angle irons done for the shelves?
Pearly!
For just a second, Pearly looked confused. Then he smiled and nodded.
Oh, I said them angle irons. And I was supposed to say those, wasn't I?
Very good.
So, Smoke, did...
Just say those.
What?
I already heard your question. Just change them to those, and I'll answer. There's no need to repeat the whole question.
Those?
Yes.
God help me, I'm surrounded by crazy people.
How's the gathering going?
It's going great. We found 47 new colts to brand, and Cal's out there with them now. I expect they're pretty close to being done.
What about the horses we're taking down to the Live Oak Ranch?
We don't have them all, but we got most of them picked out. Of course, they'll have to be broken. Boy, it sure will be good to see the Colonel again. Are you going, Miss Sally?
Pearlie's reference to Big Ben as the Colonel was because he had been a colonel during the war between the states.
Yes, Julia has invited me. So when the train leaves next Monday, I'll be on it.
Pearlie stretched.
I'll be glad when we're done here. I'm just about all tuckered out.
You aren't too tired for peach cobbler, are you?
Are you kidding? Even if I couldn't walk, I'd be able to pull myself in on my belly to get some of your cobbler.
Well, you don't have to go to that extreme. Just be cleaned up when you come to the table.
The only thing is, I feel bad about all the others. All the hands have worked as hard as Cal and I have, and I feel a little guilty about being the only ones being able to enjoy the cobbler.
You don't have to feel guilty. When I was in town, I acquired sufficient ingredients from Mr. Peabody to make enough cobbler for all of the hands.
Great. Now I not only won't feel guilty, I can eat here, then go out to the cookhouse and have seconds.
Live Oak Ranch was just north of Fort Worth in Tarrant County, Texas, and it consisted of 120,000 acres of gently rolling grassland nurtured by scores of year-round creeks and streams, which made it ideal for cattle. But the cattle that enjoyed that grass and water were different from most of the cows in Texas. They weren't longhorns. They weren't even Herefords. These were Angus cattle introduced to the range sometime earlier when Duff McAllister, Smoke Jensen, Sally, Pearlie, and Cal, as well as Matt Jensen, made a long drive to bring the very first Angus cattle into Tarrant County. Converting his herd to Angus cattle had been a particularly good investment for Big Ben Conyers, because at the current market price, one Angus cow brought half again as much as a Hereford and almost twice as much as a Longhorn. There were a dozen full-time employees of the ranch and another 8 seasonal employees. The part-time and full-time employees lived in a couple of long, single-story white bunkhouses with red roofs. There was also a cookhouse big enough to feed all of the single men, a barn, a machine shed, a granary, and a large stable. Big Ben's son Dalton and his wife Marjane lived in their own house, as did the foreman, Clay Ramsey, with his wife Maria and their young son Manny. The most dominant feature of the ranch was what the cowboys called the big house. Its architecture was an example of Spanish colonial revival, with an arcaded portico, stained glass windows, and an arched entryway. Right now, in one of the bunkhouses, Boone Calder had just heard some surprising news.
Horses? What are you talking about, Roy?
Clay said he was getting 100 new horses from Smoke Jensen.
Who's Smoke Jensen?
He's a fella that raises quarter horses up in Colorado.
In addition to Boone Calder, Roy Baker, and Gene Finley, at least 6 others who called the bunkhouse home were present for the conversation.
Folks say that his horses is the best mounts there is, and they're worth $100 to $110 a head.
Boone shook his head in disbelief at what Bert Rowe just said.
$100 a head? You can't be serious, Bert.
I'm just telling you what folks are saying they're worth.
That's a lot of money for a horse when you can get a pretty good one for $45, maybe $50.
Smoke Jensen's been real careful about growing horses. And he knows the best kind of breed and all.
You know this Smoke Jensen, do you, Roy?
Oh, yeah. Me and Gene and Clay and Dalton all met him a few years ago.
He's a gunman.
He's not a gunman. Gene, what are you talking about?
You ever know anybody that could draw a gun faster?
Well, no, but that don't make him a gunman. I generally think of a gunman as someone who ain't always on the right side of the law. Smoke always is.
I wonder if Smoke Jensen is faster than the professor.
Oh, I doubt it, Dewey.
Why'd he say that? Come on, Donnie, you ain't ever seen neither one of them draw, have you?
No, but I heard of both of them. And from what I heard, Smoke Jensen's more than likely 20 years older than the professor. And that being the case, it stands to reason that the professor, being a lot younger and all, would have to be faster.
Well, I never seen the professor draw, but I don't need to, Donnie. I've seen Smoke Jensen draw, and I'm telling you, he is faster than the professor or anyone else you might want to name.
$9,000.
What?
100 horses at $90 a piece is $9,000. That sure is a lot of money.
Drew Burgess wasn't yet 50 years old, but he looked older because his hair and deep sideburns were laced with gray. He had a rather prominent nose and a face that was always red. Burgess was the owner of the Fort Worth Livestock Exchange, and at the moment, he was standing at the bar in the Red Light Saloon. He had just bought a beer for Boone Calder, the cowboy who rode for Big Ben Conyers.
Is it true that Conyers is buying 100 head of blooded quarter horses?
Yes, sir, that's true, all right.
How did Conyers acquire them? Was the purchase arranged by Preston Miller?
I don't know. But him and Mr. Miller's been friends for a real long time. I do know that.
Yes, they have been. And I fear that friendship has blinded Conyers to anyone else who would try and do business with him. Miller does more business than the Fort Worth Stock Exchange and the Trinity River Cattle Brokerage combined. But Conyers uses him exclusively, and Conyers does as much business as all the other ranchers in the county combined. So Trinity and I have to divide the remaining business.
In a small one-room house on Grove Street in Fort Worth, Eb Lattimore just slapped the hell out of his wife, Maggie. Maggie put her hand to her cheek, which was already turning red from the blow.
Are you telling me you hoard all night and $5 is all you got?
Business was real slow. I didn't have anyone who stayed all night. I only had two for just a short time, and of the $5 apiece they gave me, I had to give half of it to Ms. Watkins. For crying out loud, Eb, you know how that works.
Eb Lattimore, who was a tall, gangly person with dark hair and eyes and about a week's growth of whiskers, stroked his chin as he stared at his wife.
If you'd get yourself a crib like I told you, you wouldn't have to share nothing with that Watkins woman and me, and you could keep it all.
No, I'm not going to become a crib whore. There don't nobody but the dirtiest and the meanest kind of men go to the cribs, and I'm afraid of men like that. Miss Watkins keeps a clean house, and the men that come there are more likely to be clean and act like a gentleman.
What the hell do you care whether they're clean or a gentleman or not? You ain't looking to marry any of them. Now get breakfast fixed. I gotta go to work.
After Lattimore left, Maggie cleaned up the breakfast dishes and considered her situation. She'd been on the line for 3 years, and though she was still an attractive woman, the dissipation of her profession was beginning to take its toll. It had been Maggie's ambition, as it was of many of her sister soiled doves, to find some man who didn't either know of her past or knew of it but didn't care. He would marry her and allow her to quit being a prostitute. When she met Lattimore, she thought he might just be the man. Lattimore obviously knew what she was because that was how they had met. When Lattimore asked her to marry him, she jumped at the chance. But after they were married, she was shocked to learn that he intended for her to continue to be a prostitute. That way he could have her anytime he wanted for free, and whatever money she made from other men would be his. Unbeknownst to Eb, Maggie held out on every third customer she entertained, keeping the money stashed in the third drawer of her chiffer robe, hidden beneath a false bottom. She had $110 so far. Lattimore worked as a hostler for the North Texas Stagecoach Company. He had just assembled an 8-horse team when Delbert Catron entered the barn. He was just under 6 feet tall and weighed 180 pounds. He stood out among his contemporaries because while most had beards or mustaches, or even just an unkempt growth by going days at a time not shaving, Catron was always fastidious in his personal grooming.
I saw the signal and presumed that it meant you had some information you wished to convey.
Catron was called the Professor by most, and the signal he mentioned was the red bandana that had been hung from a nail on the outside of the barn.
Yeah. There's a stagecoach going to Fort Worth that's going to be carrying near $1,000 today.
Meet me at the Red Light Saloon tomorrow.
Lattimore watched Catron walk away. He thought of the $100 he had just made by giving him the information about money the coach would be carrying. Maggie need never know. Smoke Jensen was at the Sugarloaf Ranch when he saw a rider approaching. He smiled because he recognized Sheriff Monty Carson.
Hello, Monty. What brings you out here?
Morning, Smoke. Didn't you have a run-in with a man by the name of Buster Crabtree a few days ago?
Yeah, I did. But nothing really came of it. Why do you ask?
He wants to see you.
You didn't have to come out here for that, Monty. Not that you aren't always welcome here, but you could have just sent Crabtree out here.
Nope, couldn't have done that. He's in jail.
Why is he in jail?
It's a little confusing. I think you might want to talk to him about that.
All right, let me change into a clean shirt and I'll come into town.
When Smoke and Monty arrived in Big Rock, they went straight to the sheriff's office. There, the sheriff led Buster out of his cell, and the three sat around his desk and had coffee while they talked.
Mr. Crabtree, Monty says that the reason for you being in jail is confusing. Can you tell me what it's about?
I turned myself into the sheriff and asked him to put me in jail.
Why did you ask Monty to put you in jail? Are you a wanted man?
I'm in jail because I want to get a job with you.
I've hired a lot of hands in my day, Mr. Crabtree. And I'll admit that I've even hired a few from jail. But as far as I know, none of them have ever had themselves put in jail just to get a job with me. I'm sure you will agree that this is a most unusual approach.
Yes, sir, I suppose it is. But let me begin talking a little bit about our run-in the other day. When I pulled a gun on that woman for helping that card shark, well, that wasn't me. I ain't never done nothing like that before in my whole life. The way you handled it, I mean, the way you stopped to find out what was going on before doing anything, told me more about you than anyone ever could tell me about you. That's why I told the sheriff I wanted to see you.
I appreciate your confidence in me, Mr. Crabtree. But that doesn't explain why you asked Sheriff Carson to put you in jail.
I know I'm going a long way around to get to the point, but hear me out. I woke up this morning, not in my hotel bed, but lying out in the gullies just east of town. I had a hangover, a lump on my head, no idea how I got there, and no money in my pocket. Someone had hit me over the head and took $21 from my pocket, which is all I had left. I tried to get a job at a few places, but nobody was interested in hiring me. Then I actually started thinking about robbing a bank or some other such thing. I've not only never done nothing like that before, I ain't never even thought about nothing like that. But there I was this morning, making plans that if I'd gone through with them, would have set me on the wrong side of the law for the rest of my life. And the fact that I actually was thinking about it scared me, to the point that, well, I thought the best thing for me to do would be to turn myself into the sheriff's office before I really did something. So that's what I done.
Buster. That's your first name, isn't it? Buster?
Yes, sir. Well, that's what I'm called, and that's what I prefer, but my actual first name is Gabe.
Buster, you keep saying that this isn't you, but you did hold a gun on that woman. And by your own admission, you did think about committing a robbery. I'm willing to accept that this isn't the real you. What I don't understand is why you did these things that aren't you.
Buster was quiet for a long moment, and Smoke was surprised and even a little embarrassed to see that Buster's eyes had filmed over with tears.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to.
No, I asked you for a job. You have a right to know as much of my background as there is. For the last several years, I've been up in Wyoming making a living by breaking horses for ranchers. That's how I came by the name Buster. But often I'd go off for weeks at a time to ride in cowboy competitions.
You're talking about rodeos?
Yes, sir. Well, my wife didn't like it. Emma said that I made enough money for us just by breaking horses for the ranchers. Like she pointed out, there was enough ranches in Wyoming to keep me more than busy, and that way I wouldn't have to be gone from home all the time. But I won a lot more often than I lost. The prize money was good, and yeah, well, to tell you the truth, I got a little full of myself. Then about 3 months ago, I came home from a trip I'd been on for a little over 6 weeks, and I found Emma dead. She'd been shot, and by the way it looked, with her clothes and all, whoever did it had his way with her. The body was already beginning to... Well, Emma must have been there for almost the entire time I was gone. It was my fault. I left her home alone so I could go out and have people applaud me. After that, Mr. Jensen, I sort of lost it. After the funeral, I just rode away. In the 3 months since then, I've gambled and drunk away just about every cent I had from the prize money, which was a little over $300. And about the only thing that's kept me away from bad women is that I can't get Emma out of my mind. Like I said, I'm not the same person I once was.
Can you still break horses?
Oh, yes, sir. That I can do.
Monty, are there any charges against Mr. Crabtree? Does he owe a fine or anything?
Nope. He's free to walk out right now.
Buster, as it so happens, I find myself in a situation where I need to break a lot of horses. Would you be interested in doing a job like that for me?
Then will you hire me?
I generally leave the hiring and firing up to my foreman, Pearly, so we'll have to see what he says. But since he works for me, I do have a little influence with him.
Thank you, Mr. Jensen. Thank you.
Do you have a horse?
Yes, sir. That's about the only thing from my past life that I do have. But he's been put up at the livery, and I don't have the money to get him out.
Well, you leave that up to me. I'll pay the bill, and you can pay me back out of your first paycheck.
Sheriff Carson?
Yeah?
I want to thank you for taking me on as a prisoner when I come in here this morning, and for feeding me breakfast.
Well, it's not often that bank robbers turn themselves into me. Especially when they haven't even robbed the bank yet.
Now, there was a part of the story that Buster hadn't told Smoke. And as he waited at the livery for Smoke to pay the bill on his horse, Buster took a piece of paper from his pocket. He showed the note to Smoke. The tortured writing read, "It was Mar."
I found this note clutched in her hand. Emma didn't finish the note, but she didn't have to. I know who she was talking about. Marvin Hayes. Like me, he's a bronco buster who breaks horses for ranchers, and also, like me, he rides in cowboy competitions. We were friends once. As a matter of fact, Marv was as good a friend as I ever had.
You say you were friends, and yet he did something like that. What ended your friendship?
I took his girl from him.
Your wife?
Emma Jean Malcolm. She and Marv were engaged when I met her. In fact, on the very day they were to be married, she ran away with me. Marv never forgave either one of us, but I never knew he'd do something like this.
Did you show the note to your sheriff?
I did, and I told him who the Mar was, but by that time Marv was gone. The sheriff put out some wanted posters on him, and I took it upon myself to find him. It wasn't until I ran out of money and leads that I had to give up the search.
He'll make a mistake someday, and you'll find him.
As sure as hell.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.